by Tribaleri, Bangalore. This is Ashwini Patil. I'll be moderating for today's session. I extend my warm greetings to all the delegates, faculty members, head of the institute, members of the industry, and other guests present today. Before we begin the session, formally, we have a short video we would like to show you guys. Over to you, Architect Siddharth. Before we start, I have a couple of important announcements. To have an uninterrupted session, I would request all the delegates and participants to kindly switch off their video and mute their audios. All the participants are requested to post their questions related to the topic in the chat box given below, which will be answered in the end of the session. Now, please may I request our director, Dr. Eric Carpenter, to welcome our incoming guest of honor, Architect Kapil Sibiya.
Thank you, Ashwini. I think there is some disturbance. Yeah. Can we have all the audios muted, please? I think it's fine, yes. Architect Kapil Sethi, born and brought up in Chandigarh, sir did his schooling from Simla, Chandigarh. An alumni of the Chandigarh College of Architecture, Kapil sir has more than 33 years of professional experience. He is also an associate member of the Institute of Town Planners for Chandigarh. Presently working as chief architect since 2014, Department of Urban Planning, Chandigarh. Sethi sir, prior to joining the Chandigarh administration in 2000, has served in CPWD New Delhi for about a decade, working on various wide varieties of public projects from campuses, hostels, housing, public plaza, training centers, embassies, etc. He was instrumental in preparing the Green Building Code for Chandigarh and was also associated with the preparation of Heritage Report and Master Plan of Chandigarh. He is the convener member of the Chandigarh Heritage Conservation Committee and board member of the Chandigarh Housing Board and also board member of Chandigarh Smart City Limited. He is the executive committee member of CSCL, Council of Architecture under the Architects Act 1972, and is also the design council member for modernization of airports by the Ministry of Civil Aviation, Government of India. He is the key officer responsible for inscription of the Capitol complex as the World Heritage Site by UNESCO. He has undertaken new programs announced by the Government of India, like the Smart City under Amrut Scheme, GIS-based Master Plan, Housing for All, presently associated in a committee on providing solution for ease of doing business through online building plan approval process by preparing Comprehensive Building Bylaws 2017 and Rural Building Bylaws. In his capacity as Chief Architect Chandigarh, has a big role in controlling all the development works, regulatory functions of Chandigarh administration, both in public and private domain. With all his busy schedule, I thank Kapil sir for taking his time out from his office and accepting to join us for this evening. Welcome sir and thank you for your time. I now pass on to Ashwini to introduce the speaker. Thank you.
We cannot solve problems using the same thinking we used when we created them, quoted by Albert Einstein, sir. With this, I warmly welcome Architect Lokinath Saha, sir, who is here with us to show insights on design thinking. Architect Lokinath Saha is an architect and environmental planner. He comes from the cultural capital of India, Kolkata. He has graduated his BA from Pilo Modi College of Architecture, Odisha, and graduated Master's in Environmental Planning and Management, SPA Vijayawada. In his Master's, he got Golden Medal and Best Thesis Award for MEPA. Professionally, he worked under Radhika Devan, Sashin Kumar, Mahomita Kundu, Dabalai EST Chipur, Land and Serve Faridabad, associated with Apgar Gurgaon. Where he handled various projects such as Gurudwara Rishikesh, commercials and resorts in Rishikesh, car projects, entertainment and amusement, redesigned entertainment blocks, parking layouts and service layouts, garden mall, Apgar project, Pura City Center. First design, internal elevation design, part of landscape, working drawings, exterior and interior elevation. Also, he designed interiors of one showroom, also handled residential in Delhi, and Hyderabad. Apart from this, is an assistant professor. Past 2 years, he has been working with. He has worked for Lovely Professional University, Akwara Punjab. Presently, he is an assistant professor under Narendrajit Kaur, Environmental Planner, SPA Delhi Architecture Department. He has done various studio and guided many students on B-axis. His research interests are as follows: ecosystem service features approach to urban wetland management, role of ecosystem livelihood management, ecosystem services, a solution to urban flood, and suitable to analyze development and physical zones of Nilgiri, multi-hazard mapping approach to vulnerability analysis, national emotion future in open. Now, please, may I request Architect Lokinath sir to start the presentation. Welcome once again, sir. Over to you.
Thank you. Thank you all the organizers for such a pleasant welcome, and I would just like to directly go ahead with the presentation and start. So I would request Siddharth, can you just share the screen and then we can go ahead with the presentation? Yes. So in the very first slide, and the today's topic of discussion is like, how do we think? Like when we talk about thinking, so every individual has got their different way of thinking, different process of thinking. So we cannot systematically, when we talk about design thinking, we cannot reframe our thinking process and confine our thought process in this particular architecture or let's say planning domain. But we cannot constrain ourselves thinking in a way where we have a very lateral or unidirectional thought process. So that's why you can just see the screen, the animation which talks about, do we have a very specific design process or do we have a, and there are a lot of, from my experience, I have come across that there are a lot of students coming, sir, what is concept? And they're not very clear what exactly a concept is, what is a design approach is. So today's presentation is on this, where we try simplifying the design learning and the design thinking with the upcoming slides. So can we go to the next slide, Siddharth? Okay. Siddharth, next slide. Yeah. So how do we think? So the first animation which appears, go back to the slide. Animation. Siddharth? Yeah. So the first animation, if you go across, so it's like, do we really exercise our brain to think, or is this the way like though we really brainstorm and then we think? Is it something that which makes us think we exercise, or we put our brain into a lot of things and then we start thinking? Is this the way? So can we go to the next animation? Can we go to the next animation, Siddharth? So the next one is observation. Yeah, that's fine. You can keep it like this. So next one is observation. When we talk about observation, so when we observe, so the process, when we really observe at something, we observe our observation. Can we achieve our research question or let's say the ideas of thinking from observation? So these are all question marks which has come up in my mind. So or there are good thoughts, bad thoughts, or poor, very situations, bad situation, good situation, which make me to think. So the answer to this is the next slide. The answer to this is the it has been proven that next slide. Siddharth, next slide. It's not changing. Yeah. So the design thing, not the thinking aspect before that. It is a bit slow. So the next design thinking believes, and it has been proven that the people who faces the problem. So it's basically the problem which triggers you to think. So everything what we think is always has it make us to go in that direction, or the thinking process develops only once we do have a problem. So it triggers, or the situation triggers, or It might be a good situation or a bad situation. It could be from an observation. So it is a process. So it's not necessary everybody reciprocated in the same way. But once people have a problem, then only which forces us to think. So there are the once you have a problem, the problem holder always have a key to their answer or the solution. So can we go to the next slide? Thinking aspects. We talked about thinking aspect. So human, it's a human-centered problem-solving tool which emphasizes empathy, collaboration, correlation, or stakeholders' feedback. So we need to understand the feasibility and behind any idea. So whenever we are taking up a project, let's say if we are taking up a thesis, or let's say we are taking up a studio project, or maybe we are taking up a commercial project in the field. So we need to understand the feasibility, and there's a some broad five phases which we come across. And we need to uncover the unmet needs of understanding their beliefs, values. Who are these people? It's the people or the user. So when we talk about the user, so users are a broad kind of, depending upon the project, what happens, the user varies. So we have a, sometimes when, suppose we can, if I'm considering a project of a resident, we have a specific client and we deal with a specific user. But when we are taking up projects or social related projects, when we have a larger user, how do we understand? So it's when we, the entire thinking aspects help us to better come up with solution once we involve the users. So we need to better understand the user needs, their beliefs and values, the pain. When I talk about the pain, I would rather suggest you experience the pain of the user. So once you experience the pain, so I usually tell my students that you must, when you visit the site, I ask them, how did you, what are the difficulties you faced? So basically those are the difficulties, are the pain of the users to reaching the site. Maybe if there's a connectivity issue, that means that's the pain a student is going through. So you need to really understand what the user is going through. What are the gains? What are the motivations? What are the behaviors of the user? Can we go next? The key principles and mindsets. So there are broadly six principles and mindset under the thinking process. It is human-centered, as I have already covered, and collaborative teamwork. Whenever we are coming up with a project, we need to have a collaborating teamwork. Learning by doing. Learning by doing is basically the experiential learning. Basically, when you visit a site and when you experience something, all your experiential learning adds on to your thinking process, which motivates you to think in a way and come up to a solution. So embrace experimentation. You should always experiment in order to get a better outcome rather than getting a better solution. So then we need to understand the pattern relationship with the surrounding. Let's say you understand the site. If I give a simple example, you understand the urban context, you understand a similar relationship with the system where the project is from, even in for some cases, the stakeholders. Then you visualize and show, that is the implementation. How do you implement it and how feasible the implementation is? So we'll be dealing all these broad things in a broad understanding in the upcoming slides. So can you go to the next slide? So, next slide. Next slide talk about the mindset, skills, and thinking. So in this process of entire thinking process, so one has got, if you talk to an individual, there is a process where we think from our heart. It's told that when there is somebody who is approaching to your thesis, we tell, you should think from your heart. You should empathize. You should adapt, adaptability of that particular project. You should live the project, basically. So that is from a mindset and attitude. That is hands-on approach and something which is hands-on approach. And that is reframing, ideation, sense-making, facilitation. So all such things, hands-on approach and heads-on approach. Heads-on approach are thought, well thought, and it is from well divergent thinking, synthesized system thinking, emotional intelligence, visual thinking, and imaginations. So these are some combination of creativity what we create today. But if we try to figure out, if I give you simple examples about hands-on this thing, when we get a commercial project, let's say we are getting a project in a like this thing where the client is on your own, then we usually do hands-on project. Like we do make facilitate them with all the facilities. We make little sense with the project, and we reframe with some other projects. Sometimes we are able to only achieve FARs and are able to provide. So that is only hands-on. So once you are doing an academic or let's say a thesis project, we must have a combination of all these three: head-on, hands-on, and hearts-on. So can we go to the next slide? So there are broad methods and tools what we discuss under this entire process of thinking, where we try to inspire, inspiration. There are five broad phases of thinking where we will be explaining into detail how. First thing is the inspiration, ideation, and implementation. Under this, there are five E phases that is that will be coming across. In five E's are emergent. If we go to the next slide, you see it is inspiration. Under inspiration, we have explore, empathize. Under ideation is the second phase. The second module where we do experiment and we engage with the project, and then finally at the implementation stage, we evolve the project. So these are the broad aspects where we are doing. But in this also, if you go back to the previous slide, you see the divergent thinking. So usually the thinking process, there are two things in the aspect. When we think divergently, that means we are creating a choice. And when we do convergent thinking, we make a choice. It is always necessary to make a, whenever we have a problem, we are giving a solution to it, but we should always look forward for an outcome to it. So when we are doing divergent thinking, we create a choice. For example, if I give you five different, if I am giving you opportunity, and if you are choosing an opportunity, that means you're making a choice. And the person who is creating opportunity is creating the choice. So it is important you should decide on which side you are supposed to choose, whether you're going to give a solution to the problem or whether you're going to achieve an outcome to the problem. Can we go next? Next slide. So next slide talks about this application. So you try to understand how divergent and convergent thinking brings into these five broad phases. So the first phase, what we'll discuss is explore. How do we explore a project and once we get it? So first thing is inspiration. Next slide. Inspiration. Where in the inspiration, the project using design thinking, suppose we are considering a project and we are using a design thinking in that project. And then purpose, so there is some situations or problems to be solved. And then they call design challenges. Basically, we come across a lot of design challenges and we take up those challenges in order to overcome those challenges and give up the solution to those challenges. So again, the second point is if you should understand whenever you're taking up a project or a thesis or a notion which you're taking up even for your research, the entire thinking process should work it out as whether it is doable, whether it is clear, actionable, and it is going to be hopefully inspiring. So something you don't add on to or contribute to your publications or something which is new is always accepted and appreciated. So your problem statement should be an outcome, not a solution. As I've been always mentioning this, your problem statement should be an outcome, not a solution. So can we go to the next slide? Okay, so now we understand when we take up a project, we need to understand the scope of the project, that is the situation or the problem what we have considered or the design challenge, the constraint, the objective and outcomes of the project tentative, and then the people who are associated with the project, that is the user group, the estimate or the finance or the resources required in the design challenges, and then the scope. The scope talks about to explore multiple alternatives to address the problem. And finally, the design challenges that frames the problem statement and how we might address to the problem. So can we go to the next slide? So this is the basic scope. When you get a project, we need to figure out all this aspect, S, C, O, P, E, and S, in order to understand. So now we discuss the first phase, first module, that is inspiration, that is first phases, we explore it and we empathize it. So how do we explore the particular project? In the under this explore stage, we have four methods of doing methods and tools how we are able to explore a particular project at the very initial stage. And then can we go to the next slide? Okay. When we talk about the explore phase, focuses on remaining the design challenge topic into design opportunity for multiple perspectives. So when we come across these explore phase, basically we are exploring the project in different phases where we are able to understand the design challenge, and we are giving we are giving the topic into design opportunity for multiple perspectives. We need to see explore the project from different aspects in order to overcome. We can give the best solution, and it's not necessary we give only a solution architecturally, but also maybe socially, or maybe, you know, there are different other perspectives which we can take care with the help of architecture. So there are some four phases which we'll be discussing in the upcoming slides. We can skip this and we can go to the next slide directly. Steep analysis is the first thing. So steep analysis we usually do, we need to understand at the very preliminary stage of design, once we get the project, or we need to explore it at the best, we need to do some steep analysis where we explore and determine the impact of micro environment trends in the context of the project topic. Basically, the challenges, what the design challenges we can provide, we need to explore it, and we need to do a steep analysis where you should not limit your thinking just to the people or the design, what you're designing for, as I just now told, but you should also think the aspect of, let's say, the finance, the fiscal planning, or the government aspect, the different stakeholder, how these different stakeholders are playing this role. So steep analysis is thus required, where we are able to bind the different sectors together, and we are able to take care that all the pieces have been taken care in the thinking process. So that's why we need to include this in our thinking process. Can we go to the next slide? Okay. How do we conduct a steep analysis? I think we can skip this slide. I'll explain the slide with the help of the examples. So we have to evaluate opportunities and challenges. Okay, so we reframe the design. Basically, we have reframed the design challenges, and then we try to list down the opportunities. Yes. So in this example, which is a template which helps you, first you need to categorize the different sectors which you are going to cover in the project, and you can categorize the sectors. You need to categorize their challenges and opportunities with relation to the sectors. Can you go next? Next slide. So this is talking about the steep analysis. This is another example of doing steep analysis, where you categorize the matrix into high impact and less low impact, where the uncertain to occurrence. You go to the next slide, you'll understand better. Next slide. So steep analysis, these are the results of the steep analysis prioritization. When you have a discussion where you have the high impact likely to occur of the quadrant from the, this is a carry forward of the previous slide, the metric which you've seen. So discuss, and the second one, the high impact uncertain to occurrence quadrant. So you need to list down what are the uncertain to occurrence quadrant and what are the likely to occurrence quadrant. Next slide. So these are the steep analysis. This is how you need to understand the project and come up with the opportunities to do the steep analysis. We go to the strategic priorities, which is the second one. The strategic priorities we need to also prioritize. Once we understand the issues, next slide. Once we understand the strategic priority, we need to prioritize our perspective to gain insight and deep understanding of the design challenges. Basically, we need to understand what is our priority to address the design. Once we list down the challenges and opportunities, we need to figure it out and strategize it in with the help of priorities. And you can go to the next slide with the examples. You can skip all the steps because I won't be reading through all the steps, because I'll directly explain it through the examples. Okay. So you have this strategic matrix again, which is going to prioritize and help you how to strategize your priorities, which is urgent and important, is in the first quadrant. The second quadrant, which is less urgent and important. So if this process is being superimposed in your design thinking, so this will help you out to guide you in a process where you can even think the simplest, or let's say the complex things, thinking can be brought into simplified manner. We can go to the next slide. Strategic priorities, after strategic priorities. So these are some of the questionnaires which if you are addressing to the synthesis and you make sense of to these questionnaires. Go next. Go to the next slide. So we'll be talking about activity systems. Next slide. Activity systems. So basically, Siddharth, next slide. visual representation of how the organization creates values and satisfy its user and build competitive advantage. So basically what it does is it represents how the organization is creating an importance of that particular product. We need to understand also identify gaps and achieving the objective that is providing services. Basically, we need to have a framework where we are able to provide what are the activities or the services which we are going to add on to the project, which is going to increase the hedonicity or the, let's say, the hedonic value of the project. So this is basically activity system, which we usually add up in the at the very exploratory state, depending upon the existing situation and understanding of the project. Next slide. Yeah, so this is an activity system mapping template where you can strategize your different sectors, and you need to try to reframe your activities, what all you can add under your objectives or a mission. So this can be a mission statement where you are having some strategy 1, 2, 3, 4, where you can add on activities to be, and those activities can conduct it through some events or tasks like surveys or like, you know, initial primary data collection, which will help you out to give a result and a direction for what are the services you're going to provide for the project. Can we go next? Next slide. So again, key components of activity system, you can do a bubble kind of templates where you are able to make the connections and supporting services which are going to add up. So this is a sample, like if you are taking up a topic and going to link it up. So whenever you're taking up a research and you have two or three words, what I suggest always to my students is you take up those words and try to explore it at the maximum, that nobody knows it better than you. So once you explore it at with this linkage and this connection, and then you will be able to find a lot of links between these words, and then you will be able to relate and come up with some kind of research question, or maybe you might come up with some more like, you know, you can explore it to come up with more activities or more interesting innovative research questions to these activities. Okay, next one. Okay, the next one is stakeholders analysis. Stakeholder analysis is very important because once you are taking up a project, you need to understand who are the people who are associated with the project. Other than the user, of course, user is associated with the project, and also the people who are associated with the project, the group, the organization, the financing people. You can go next. Financing people that have a direct influence on the design challenges, and understand the key stakeholders so that we can engage them better and we can make use of them in a better way to structure the project. So that's why we need to also explore the stakeholders who are going to, at the very initial stage, at the very initial module, where we know which are the stakeholders we need at what stage. So then we need to basically categorize these stakeholders. Can we go to the next slide? We need to categorize these stakeholders as per their priority. Again, the can we go to the next matrix? Next slide. So high interest, low interest, influence people, not this, the previous one. So the high interest, the low interest, the previous slide. Yes. So the low interest, the people who are getting influenced. So you need to put all the listed stakeholders. When you're exploring the stakeholders, you need to put them up in a manner where you know these are the phases where I would need to approach these kind of stakeholders. Now we can go to the next slide. So then you need to build up the relation and linkages with the stakeholders. Whether, for example, next slide, Siddharth. Basically, next slide. Not this, the previous one. So we need to understand what are the linkages between the stakeholders, how we are able to build the relationship and the map their templates in order to understand what, where and when, which stakeholder has an interdependency on the other stakeholder. So all this thing we explore at the very initial design stage. Can we go to the next slide? So we have again developed the high interest. We need to satisfy the high interest and low influence people. We need to engage closely in the high interest and high influence people, and then the stakeholders basically. The low interest and low influence people need to be monitored with minimum effort and keep satisfied low interest and high influence people. We can go to the next one. So this is all about the stakeholders mapping, and this is another format where these are some of the different ways of approaching and understanding, exploring the different stakeholders at the very initial stage of your research, or let's say your thesis. Okay, this is again the key stakeholders and their relationship. This is the same thing what you have done. It's in a tabular format. That's it. We can go next. Okay, so we can go to the next slide. That is the framed opportunities. Now we need to frame the opportunities from all this exploring, understanding. We need to frame opportunities. What opportunities? The design challenges, ensuring all relevant notes have been considered before reframing the design challenges, and transform the design challenges into design opportunities with many possibilities. We must take care of the opportunities in a way where we have multiple options, where we have provision. For example, when you're designing, let's say a residence, you need to think of it as from the user perspective, of course, but you also need to give more optional, more provisions in order to convert, or let's say we need to reuse, adapt to those buildings with different functions. If in case of future, we need to readapt those, adapt those buildings with different use, adaptive reuse if you want to do in case. So this is all about framing opportunities. And then we talk about there are some industry or public sector agency to the citizen end user. The next slide. So the fundamental opportunity framing is, there are three broad aspects. Go to the next slide. The three broad aspects where public sector agency to the citizen ends fund. So public sector, there is an agency which goes to the citizen end fund. Then from a single idea to the system. So from single person to the entire system, you need to provide this is the opportunity framing. And then from symptoms to the root cause, we need to understand the real issue, pain points, and underlying the deep needs. So all this thing need to be understood when we are framing the opportunity. So these are, again, next slide. These are some of the templates which have been followed where the project brief is being given. We can go to the next slide. We can just skip this template. These are just templates for your understanding examples. So these are some of the templates where we are understanding the goal and objectives of the design challenges, the targets, and all these things. So we'll go to the next phase, that is empathize. So why do we need to empathize and consider the project at this stage where we are building our feelings and understanding the feelings of the user is important. Why is it so important today? Like whenever we need to have a session with the client to understand the project, their needs. So basically, when we talk about thinking or giving a problem, a solution to a problem, the concept is nothing but as an approach to answer to all the problems or the issues what is being suggested or the recommendations given by the client. We are addressing it and we are coming up with a solution. So in the empathize, we need to understand mechanism to understand and share the feelings of your user to focus deep user understanding. Why do we need to understand the user so well? So, for example, if you are designing a residence, and when you are designing a kitchen for your client, we need to talk to the homemaker or the person who is definitely using the kitchen for most of the time. So we need to work as per the ease and comfort of the user, specific to the spaces and the requirements in the design. So that's the reason we need to understand and empathize with the user group. So empathize is used to uncover the deep user insight and need to be gaining broader perspective of the citizen's life. So we go to the first thing under empathize, that is the observation. So observation is something which I initially talked about. Observation is something which you see or you reconnaissance when you go to the site, or maybe once you're visiting to the client, you need to observe a lot of things. So you need to do shadowing a day in life. So it's also important that if you observe a person in a formal way, it is not necessary that maybe the person is projecting you to be like that, but you need to get involved in their regular discussions in order to understand the the root insight issue of the user. If you understand, so you need to observe the people in the natural environment rather than the formal environment, what it is it says. So you can do it with these broad things, that shadowing. Fly on wall is maybe you can understand it as it's an observer supervision with a CCTV camera or something. Site visit, body storming and all this. You can go to the next slide. So these are the observation where during observation you need to be very attentive, curious, perceiving it with your all senses. You need to be very active with all your senses and open-minded to learning. So you should always look at an issue with multiple aspects and have an understanding towards it from different aspects. You should not confine your thinking in one direction, rather think it in an open-minded way. So you should see different possibilities and provisions with all the issues. Then we talked about, we need to look beyond the obvious. So basically we are talking about when our observation should not be, you should look beyond, our observation should be something which we are going to explore it beyond the reconnaissance. What we do has to be beyond our simple observation. We need to always question ourselves why. It's not just what and why. We need to understand the relation, behavioral pattern, interaction, the gaps. So all this and the mistakes, of course. So whenever you're having a conversation with someone, or let's say you're discussing issues, or you're observing a city, or you're observing at your site or your surrounding, you need to observe all minute things at beyond the obvious. Okay. So for this, you can go, you can take help of a poems framework. Go to the next slide. The poems framework talks about, poems framework will help you to guide the people. You can understand the people, the objects, P for people, O for objects, E for environment, V for the media or message, and the services. So basically all this aspect needs to be understood. So these are some of the questions which you can address when you can go in for a reconnaissance survey or an observation. Can we go to the next slide? This is a framework template which will help you out to know what is the correct thing to observe. So methods and tools of observation, it is the context inside. The context is basically where, when it has to answer all this. The context when you study, basically you need to understand where, when, who and why. So, and then the insights, what have you learned about your target users? So then you need to have deep interaction with the people so that you can understand the users very nicely. Challenges, opportunities and perspectives, of course. So these things have to be taken care of once you're doing an observation. Go to the next slide. Okay, so field observation preparation. So when we prepare for field observation, these are the four broad things which you need to take care. So first thing is who and where to observe. So you need to understand, think about the profile of your target. So maybe if you're going to a government office to interact with someone, you need to be prepared with the question. You need to understand what kind of profile you're going to interact with. So the second one is, what are the different roles of your team members? So you have always been observed, like when somebody is interviewing someone, there are a set of panels, there are different people who are there, who is doing one task at a time. That is, when you are speaking, somebody is observing you, somebody is taking notes, and somebody is also interviewing you and questioning you. So whenever there is an integration which is happening, there are different aspects which need to be taken care of. So you need to be well prepared before your field observation. So what to observe and learn. Think about the issues, concern, and the targets which you have already done from your exploring stage. You have framed some issues and observed, and you need to target those issues. You need to come up with their participation so that you can resolve what is their aspect of how they want to address the issue as. So inventory check before setting. Inventory check is basically all your pen, paper, camera, all those documents, etc. things which you need to carry before observation. Next slide. So when the next stage is user interview. So we know we have been interviewing people, and then how we interview, we do surveys, we do a primary survey, and where we are going to interview. What are the things we need to take care? You need to take care of the behavior and feeling, the goals which you have already set up in your questionnaire, the motivations, the aspiration, the values, beliefs, and the pain and challenges. Until and unless you understand the pain of the user, you are not able to live the project, and you are not able to come up with a good solution. So the next stage is when we do deep user interviews, we need to take care of these three broad distinct stages of the interview. That is pre-interview preparation, during the interview, and post-interview. So what do we do in all the stages? Next slide. So in the pre-interview preparation, what we have two types of questions. So One is the type A, that is the close-ended questions, where you cannot directly ask the question because you can need to talk to the person and extract some answers. What you want to, what is your basic outcome of your questionnaire? You need to achieve it through discussion. So sometimes you cannot directly ask them for this thing. So there are some questions which are open-ended, which you can directly ask their name, age, all such things. Then you need to do an empathy map, and you need to do a journey map. A particular person, you need to understand how a systematic activity mapping or a journey map is being done in order to understand their empathy and how they are being related to. And you need to relate to think, feel, say, to do, hear, pain and gain. All these things, words are very important to in order to, which will help you to generate the questionnaire basically. Next slide. So this is the first template which will help you to do the mapping and the questionnaire basically. These are in broad explicit think and feel, hear, see, do and say. All the things which I have mentioned is some just generic questionnaires which will help you out to guide how to frame your sample empathy map when you are doing a sample empathy mapping. Okay, the next one, next slide. This is the sample journey map. So journey of the particular user needs to be sketched out in this particular sequence so that you're able to relate it, and then you can structure this journey and you can find out those issues at this particular point, at this particular stage of the journey. If this is a particular issue, so that can be explained and that can be resolved. You can highlight that at that point of time. Can we go to the next slide? So this is a combination of empathy and journey map to generate interview questions. So basically when you're finding an interview question, so what you do is you need to collaborate these two mapping in order to come up with the results of the question. So can we, because these are basically correlations, and if you are able to correlate these studies, and then you can come up with new issues. Okay. And you can understand the actual root cause of the issue, which they are not able to convey you or directly say you, this is a particular issue. They might not be realizing that issue, but you might get it with this correlation study. Okay. So there are five activities you need to do during the interview. That is, you need to ask questions, listen to them, observe, sense, make inferences. Sense means you need to make inferences at that point of time, and then also record everything. Okay. Can we go to the next slide? And the last stage, that is the post-interview discussion template. So we need to, it is also important, pre-interview we have a framework of questions, but post-interview it is equally important that you debrief the presentation templates. So basically what you have gathered from the site, you need to debrief it in order to form in the form of presentation template, so that you are able to come up, you can catch hold of small issues which might be left. So this is one of the examples. This is how you can reframe or deframe your brief presentation. Can we go to the next slide? Next slide. So next one is need findings. Need findings. So why need finding is important? So we need to understand and study a pattern relationship with the help of terms FICE. That is again a breakdown which will be coming up. We need to, and SAM, these are some of the breakdowns with full forms which will help you to guide where these frameworks will uncover insights, aspiration, motivation, challenges, pain points, and deeply. So to understand the need, it is important that you follow these two frameworks which are upcoming in the next slide. Go to the next slide. Next slide. You can skip one slide. Yeah, you can skip this because this is the method I'll explain it through the example. How to uncover user insights. So basically, how do we uncover? We can skip this five principles. The five principles we skip? Yeah, no, we can get back to the five insights. So user insight in a human truth, the previous slide, I skipped accidentally. So the user insight in a human truth, the user insight digs deeper than observation. So what you are doing in observation, the user insight basically goes deeper into more than observation. So user insight offers new untapped understanding. So sometimes we cannot understand what is the issue completely, but the user insight process will give the entire deep user insights details, and where user insights shape new perspective and challenges to old assumptions. There might be some old assumptions, so they can give a newer perspective to it. So user insight serves a foundation to unlock creative thinking. So basically, there are a lot of creative thinking which is done, and it can the user insight can be done through this user insight, these five principles which are covering under user insights. So can we go to the next slide? So what is the next thing? What we do in the next slide is, you can see for need findings, if you are covering all this, recognizing the relationship, where you are able to build the connections, events, causes and effects, gaps, if you're able to interrelate all these things, and then you are able to search everywhere, look beyond obvious. So basically, I have discussed all these things. If you are putting it all these things together in one page, then you will be able to find the needs. So why? Basically, you need to find the seek the wisdom of why. So to recognize the relationship and seek the wisdom of why through this particular relationship chart. I mean, the format. Next, can you go to the next slide? What do we have next? Okay. So now we were talking about the SAM, that is the social context. You need to understand the social context in order to answer to these all questions. Then you need to understand their behavior and the action, how people are reciprocating towards that environment, and their motivation. So what do they think? How do they feel? And what are the reasons for action? How they are behaving, that why they are behaving that way, their belief, values, thinking. So because why we are discussing the need findings and the user perspective, because there are projects which we take up a lot of, many a times what happens, there are projects, successful projects we take up, and there are projects are failure. There are less acceptance of the project from the users. So we need to do this study in order to make sure those users are involved at the very initial stage, and they are involved, and so that we are able to make sure the acceptance factor is happening. So then we have the SAM framework of insight. When you bring this social context, action, behavior, and motivation together in a single framework, and then you can understand the user insight and all this together, and then you can understand the needs. And we go to the next slide. Similarly, there is uncover the insights to the user needs with SAM framework. SAM framework is basically this which we were discussing earlier. Next. So this, then I talked about the SPICE need framework. That is the next one. SPICE talked about the social issues, the trust, qualified counsel, resources, services, all this, the social things. What does the person need from relationship with the people around them? Basically, the social aspect, the physical aspect, the identity, communication, and emotional aspects of the user. So that's how you'll be able to find all the needs from the user then. Can we go to the next slide? So this is a tool, an example, which is talking about when you're taking or targeting a particular user group or a human, you need to understand all this, how it is impacting the human needs, want, their aspiration, challenges, through the different aspects. You should always bubble it out with their psychological factor, the social and cultural aspect factor, the situational factor, the personal factor, and also the personality factor. You can go to the next one. So the last one is the persona development. The persona development is nothing but you're humanizing your target user.
Am I audible? So you're targeting a user, where you're targeting a user, and in order to, you're going to, it can be fictional character, where you're imagining that character in order to form a question and experiment on that character. What could be the question and what could be the reciprocal? How will that particular character reciprocate, or the user group would be reciprocating with the different solutions or different ideas which you are bringing up? Can you go to the next slide? You can skip the next slide, how to develop the persona, and then the next slide. So you see the templates to be used in the persona development. First, you review all finding things. First, you review them all, then determine the number of personas to create. So you might categorize few persona where you are able to target. These are the, let's say, women. If you are doing a project, let's say into inclusive planning with the economic weaker section, or let's say a women
women, like, you know, women, specifically for the women or transgender or something specific group. You can target those user group and try to question, have a persona developed and then question them and answer to them like in that character way. So complete, basically role play kind of thing. So complete the refined persona using the templates and describe and sketch out the persona details. So next are the next slides are some of the templates which say the rapid persona development canvas is there. This is the format where you are developing a persona and then you are explaining, filling up the details to get this. Can we go to the next one? So this is the sample persona presentation. This is an example which has been given. This is how you can come up with the results of the persona presentation, sample presentation. Next is ideation. That is the second module where we need to experiment the project with the help of ideation, where we do team building activity basically. Ideation, under ideation, we have experiment and engage. So engage. So how do we get engaged to the project and how do we experiment our ideas? And the prototypes, or basically the case studies and the prototypes, how do we experiment it? And then how do we understand it from the experience design? Next one. Next slide. So the ideation is basically the huge quantity of ideas are generated by brainstorming sessions. So there are a lot of brainstorming sessions where we are able to do the ideation process. So now when we do the ideation, there are three broad ideation process. Where tools which helps you, ideation by Scamper, that is a tool to generate new ideas from different perspective. Ideation by analogous inspiration, that is basically understanding it from an existing study or innovative ideas which have been taken from existing case studies or something like that. So ideation by deconstruct and reconstruct. We'll discuss all this in detail. Can we go to the next slide? So Scamper. So through Scamper, again, we need to, it stretches on the parameters of thinking to generate new ideas from different perspectives. So Scamper, we need to substitute in an idea. We cannot be very flexible and we cannot be very rigid. We need to be very flexible. We need to be flexible in order to, in terms of if we want to subtract something, if we want to add something, or if we want to adapt something new, or if we want to modify or magnify or minify something. So put to others use how we can make use of this of the particular innovation or particular design into others this thing. How, and we should also have guts to eliminate things. We should also have an acceptance factor to remove something, because by something removing also the design might get enhanced. Sometimes even minimalistic designs also comes out to be very good. So we should know also how to subtract and eliminate. So reverse and rearrange is the last one. Okay, can we go to the next ideation, that is analogous? You can skip this. These are some of the examples. Scamper is done. Scamper ideation, you can do the Scamper and you can do different ideation with different color chits, and then you can do this Scamper in relation to the S-C-A-M-P-E-R thing. We can go to the next one, that is analogous. Analogous, next slide. Directly you can skip, go to the analogous. Yeah, you can directly go to the image example. That will be best example and which everybody can understand with the picture. Yeah, this one. So you can see this is a building, and then how this building has been particularly been taken initiative, and then how it has been modified and it has been inspiration. So you might have come across, in my experience I've seen in first semester, there are a lot of students who come up across, if I ask them to designers chaos, they come up across an ice cream parlor, they definitely directly implement that ice cream parlor and then say this is a concept. So this is also an inspirational concept or thinking process where you get inspired from a particular idea or a particular analogy which you can equal it to the model. So this this particular process explains you better with this image. Can we go next? So you can see, compare this Google, and again there is a comparison with Google and Apple descriptions, and then how analogies are done in the analogy inspiration example. Next. Okay, then ideation using analogous inspiration is the image. This is how it is being done. Next slide. So we can directly go to the deconstruct and reconstruct. Siddharth.
Deconstruct and reconstruct is basically taking a product or service and initially breaking it down. So basically, it is a top-down and game method where we are able to take up the essential issues and we try to break it down. So whenever what we do is, when we have a project, we try to break down the project into different schedule and then we assign the project. Similarly, your issues need to be broken down and then reconstruct those issues in different parts to give a generic solution. Okay. So this is all about deconstruct and reconstruct. Can we go to the next slide? So the best example would be the image. Can you go next? So how can we deconstruct and reconstruct from this image? You can see how can you do this with the help of this example. This is best understood with this example. We can go to the next one, I guess. Okay, so this is how the team deconstructing and reconstructing can be done separately. And then you can come up to a solution with this reconstructing and deconstructing. Okay, then there are some ideation and of the steps which are to be done. We will just brush this very fast. Then let's start with your most realistic persona. Basically, you need to take up a persona and then most compelling deep into your unmet needs. So we can go to the next one. After taking considering the persona, we need to frame the needs and possibility questions, how we might to inspire possibility thinking. This all things have been done in the previous stages. So this is an elaboration where the deconstruct process also includes the entire process where we have discussed earlier. So you can brainstorm and rearrange of different ideas with the help of POEMS or SCAMR framework. Okay, next, step three. Step four is clustering and identifying themes. With this, you need to identify and cluster these themes separately so that you can come up with a combination and that would be your innovation. Next. So clustering ideas by theme templates is this. And we go next. So now form idea to concept. Yeah, this is very important. So when people ask me what is a concept or what is a big idea, now this is an answer. It's a meaningful and seamless combination and or an integration of related ideas. So basically, whatever is your ideas, which is meaningful, you have to best address to your user with the target users as per their needs. So whenever you are able to answer to the needs of the users with your ideas and innovation, and which has to be meaningful, of course, which has to be meaningful. So then it is called as a concept. Can we go to the next slide? So this is idea selection and depending ideas. So this is a stage where you are able to conceptualize your design or thinking. Then concept development steps. After concept development, the idea selection and depending ideas, and then you have concept development. And then the last one. Now we will talk about the experience design. So what is experiential design? Sometimes what we when we experience something, we learn a lot. So for example, there was a situation where I sent few of my students to understand the urban context or the, let's say, the activity mapping. We send them to different open spaces and they could categorize what are the activities happening. So this is something which they are learning out of their experience. They are going to that place, they are viewing it, they are discussing with people, they are experiencing what kind of place needs what kind of activities. So this is also a strategy. This is an example which I give for experiencing design. And also maybe case studies, or you can experience and you can frame such timelines with the help of experience learning. Can you go to the next slide? With the help of experience learning. And then these are some of the experience learning examples where how you can jot down those examples and strategize it. Then coming to this. So you once you understand the experience learning, how people are experiencing it and what is the situation. You see this mark, the graphs, which is in, which is changing with the activities, whether they are happy, they are sad, or whether they are like, you know, this thing, their emotional values are being expressed in this graph, which is talking about the emotional symbol, which you can give narrative to the described behavior and emotions of the person in the journey. So when you are doing the journey, which I have discussed earlier, when you are doing the journey, you also need to understand the emotions. So when they are telling which is the happiest moment when they are into their entire journey. So we need to understand that people are willing to spend more time in this particular area in relation to the space. So there are researches where people are also measuring, like, you know, we have worked one on measuring emotions, how they are related to the spaces, how they can quantify how emotion could be one of the aspect of design thinking. Okay, so next. So this is a complete user experience journey where you are setting up the experience journey in relation to the emotions, the need, motivation, aspirations, all these things. Like, you know, they're basically all your emotions are expressed in this experiential learning. And then the prototyping. So what is prototype? Prototype, next slide. Prototype is an approach that makes ideas and concepts more tangible and visual as compared to written ideas. So this is simple. In simple words, if I go ahead, if you go to the next slide, you will see it is the prototypes what we make. That is the model making, which helps you to come up with some small kind of pilot projects where you can do it and then execute it and see how things are going to work and how is it being executed. Next one. Next slide. So this is how the prototyping is done. For big ideas, you cannot directly implement at a 1:1 scale or at a site level. Rather, you should make some prototypes in order to understand the prototype. So when we discuss the last, after this, this is the experiment stage we finish. We discuss the fourth one, engage. Next slide. So that next slide. We can go to the engage. In engage phase four, yes. Engage is basically what we do is give user the walkthrough experience using ideal user experience journey. So we need to understand in this we have storytelling and co-creation. Where in storytelling, we need to understand when we are engaging with this particular, we are getting involved in such a way, we are expressing all the needs in the form of story, where we understand the persona of a person, and then we are able to express it in with an case, and we try to experiment it. Okay, so the storyboard, there are storytelling can be done using for these three. One is the role play, that is the persona. You are playing a role of a particular individual, and one could be the prototypes, and one could be the storyboard. Okay, basically storytelling gives voice to the persona's story. So some person's story can be expressed with the help of the design, okay, or maybe some research or maybe your planning studios also can be done. So you have next is the storyboarding. So in the storyboarding, visually it has a, if you see the image, the storyboarding, it is basically how we picturize the thing, visual describe series of activities for the solution idea. So if you want to give an idea, you can do sketch out some schematic sketches where could give a particular solution to it. If you go to the next slide, it will better explain you with this image. You see what are the drawing pictures, the pictures which have been drawn and how things have been explained with this visual story. So these are storyboarding. So and before doing, next slide, can you go to the next slide? Before doing the storyboarding, if you are having this structure where it is the persona and you are understanding the beginning stage, the middle stage where you understand the deep needs, the pain, and then you are giving a resolution or meeting the needs, you are answering to their solution or your outcomes, and then you are giving your ideas are being executed with the help of concept and the solution provided. So this is how we get engaged with this, and with the help of storyboarding, you are able to get engaged with this. So next one is co-creation. So co-creation is, again, we need to understand engaging the target users early in the development process for your solution ideas. So basically some tentative ideas you need to have. So you need to involve people. So you need to understand the perspective of the public. So it is basically nothing but the public participation at different stages of design, or let's say different stages of development of master plan or any kind of concept which you come up. If you even for, let's say, if you're designing a product also, if you can take such co-creation aspects. Okay, so this is the stage. We can go to the next slide. So this is the format of steps involved in co-creation session, which shows the diagram below. Okay, so this is how the co-creation can be done with the preparation of these questions, some questions, and we can go next. So the last one is implementation. So the last module, which is implementation, which talks about evolve. Under evolve, we have how do we evolve? That is implementation, that is solution testing. So before we execute the project at site, we need to experiment that project at some stage where we are able to give a solution to it. So there are some strategic requirements which need to be done. So that is the strategic requirement and the implementation of the plan that will deliver, achieve the big idea solution videos for earlier phases. So there are some phases which have been there earlier and which you need to execute with the help of this CAP. So what is CAP? It's basically the capability and assets, activity system and workflow. That is basically the process and the people and value. So all these things are the basic purpose of giving feasibility. So you need to understand whether this strategic things are feasible and which can be implemented at the implementation stage. Then evolving activities. We can go next. These are some examples. You can go next. Yes, this is some example of the strategic requirement, how you can frame the strategic requirement. We can go to evolving activity. So evolving activity is leveraging or evolving, defining the current system and process to work smarter, not harder. So basically you need to give solution concept by integrating the solution components. And so you might have a single solution for 3 or 4 problems. So basically if you evolve with the activity system, so you need to build those relations with the activities in order to come up with a common solution so that we spend less finance or less money. It could be cost effective to give one solution to multiple issues. Okay, so these are the example of this student-driven real-world learning of this is example. Then we have the visibility analysis. So viability analysis is also important. We need to assess the viability for the proposed solution which you are going to get it done at the site or let's say the product which is going to come up. So how it impact creates on different stakeholders. It is also important to understand how your project or the product is going to get into the market and let's say different stakeholders, how are they going to accept it. So viability is important at a stage where before implementation, we need to really evolve it with this. Okay, we'll go next. Yes, this is how we use it. So these are 4 S where we use the stakeholder satisfaction, social value creation, program sustainability and program scalability. So all these 4 things need to be taken care of in this. Can we go to the next slide? Then we have innovation, tools and user needs. We discussed what is need, CAPs and 4 S. We have discussed capability, assets, resource, activity, system, workflow and people, cultural change and adaptation management. So there are some user desirability, technical feasibility and viability which need to be taken care under this activity system integration. And can we go to the next slide? So in this relation, we need to understand this process innovation where we are able to build the user desirability, the technical feasibility and the 4S, that is the visibility. So we need to understand this relation in order to get the marketing and branding innovations of the particular product or let's say the design or let's say if you want to sell a particular dwelling unit or whatever. Okay, so next, so user experience innovation can be achieved with this. Next slide. So we have change management where the change management tool using review. This is done with the help of a review tool. Review is one tool which can be done in this process, which has people-centric process, tools and techniques for managing people's side of the change. Okay. So we need to understand the people. So reason for change, you need to answer to the review. So how we review it, reason for change, engage staff and then visualize the vision of change, initiate implementation, empower people for the change and quick wins. So what are quick wins? So we'll go next slide. Next slide. So this is an example again for the change management and then next slide. Next slide is quick wins. Quick wins are also important at every stage of our project because this provokes you to for the success of the project. So every early small successes which are relatively cheaper. So there are small investments which are done in order to enhance the project and in order to make increase the valuation of the project, increase the value of the project. So improvement, it is exactly like, you know, trailers, how movie trailers have been coming up. So it is those such quick wins are something, some small investments which are done for a greater improvement and it is being done. So can we go to next one? Example of quick wins. So how quick wins can be done through this identifying the selecting quick wins with this help of chart. Okay, so you have to take up the quick wins at the high priority where the impact is more, so that it will be easy to implement at the last stage. So quick wins will build a nice relation and a nice advertisement for the people once they are achieving the product or the things. So the next slide, which talks about quick wins and examples, and the last slide. Can we go to the last slide? Action planning to advanced design challenge project. So in this slide, you see how do we use this particular action planning to advanced design challenge project. So what we do is, as a team, we discuss a plan how your team intends to bring your project forward into a pilot testing. Pilot testing is a small testing which is being done in at a smaller scale, a small unit. For example, a small unit is being tested whether it is going to work nicely. So it is pilot testing, and implement some of your ideas in that pilot testing so that you can understand at smaller investment whether whether it is going to be accepted by the people, or people are liking it, or whether it is in demand. So your plan should be clearly detailed, and what, why, who, how, and when in taking your project has to be clearly executed with this help of action planning. So this is all about all the five phases of design thinking, which I have discussed little elaborated, where I have to go a little faster, and because it was a pretty lengthy content, and I tried explaining it in a more precise manner. So I thank everyone for patiently listening to this, and we are just done with the presentation with this. And if any questions, we can go ahead with the questions as we start.
Thank you, sir. So, heading the session to question and answers, we have a couple of questions here. With the pandemic severely limiting the physical exploration part of the design,
you're not very clearly audible. Can I, once again? Can you tell me?
Again? With the pandemic severely limiting the physical exploration part of the design process and the research mainly based on virtual internet exploration, how do you think students should go about the project?
How do you think students should go about?
About the project. Like
about the project. Okay.
Yes.
Okay, I got it. So with the kind of, so this is a very interesting question. And before I take up the question, I would answer to this. See, being an architect and users, and when I talked about the heads-on design, the hands-on design, there are architects which we execute this hands-on design at first hand, where we directly implement, not thinking about, let's say, the ventilation, let's say, not the user perspective. We do not think about it. We try to achieve it with the minimal FAR, commercially achieving it. But with this pandemic situation, it is now very clear today that the situation has made us realize how important our living or livability inside our home is important. Because earlier, the users always did this timeline activity where they understood 9 to 5 is office. I'm in AC setting, so I do not need to put an AC inside my home. So let's make it less mechanized inside my home. So these are some of the initiatives which we always can explore in the thinking process with the issues. As I started with this, always when there is a problem, only then we are able to address the issues. Being such fine architects, there are a lot of flaws we still learning. It is still in our learning process where we are able to answer to these today. Such issues are addressed where we are realizing, yes, this much percentage of open ventilation is required in spite of such plots which have been there. So these are always the problems which are targeted, and we give outcome to those problems. Thank you.
So one more. Due to COVID-19,
you're little low. Your sound is coming little low, actually.
Due to COVID-19, thesis students have restrictions to do case study.
You too? One second. Can I reconnect it once, please? Can I reconnect it once?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now you're audible. Yes. Okay. The next question is, I'm still low.
Hello. Yes. Next question is. Now you're audible.
Yes. Due to COVID-19, CC students have restriction to do their case study. We want suggestions on this, though.
You see, I have discussed a lot of part where we are doing a ground study and the primary study which has been done, but there are always prototype studies are being always executed. The researchers which are already published researchers can be taken as the case studies. Yes, this is a pandemic situation where we are addressing this issue, and it is a real issue. I am always in a favor the learning what we experience. I always tell my student that if you have gone to a site and they told me I was dealing with a multimodal transit hub in the previous semester. They told me, sir, we could not enter the site. We had to go through the railway track. So then I told them, this is what is the issue you can find. You can figure out the issue. Until and unless you go to the site, how would you understand the pain of the people who could not address the linkage? So that's why we later addressed it as first the minor project as we came up with the master plan. We came up with the proposal of all the roads first. We tried figuring out what are the issues. If linkage to the site or the connectivity of the site is an issue, the student could only understand once they have been there. Because from Google Earth Pro or something, which is, yes, there's definitely a deficiency, but in terms of other this thing, a lot of softwares, GIS and other things are helping you out. The DEM files, the satellite images. So you can do a nice study even at this situation. We should consider it.
Thank you, sir, for showing us how thoughtful we can be with our thoughts in design. Now, may I please invite our guest of honor, architect Kapil Sethia, sir, to share his valuable insights. Kapil, sir?
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Yeah.
Yes, sir, we can.
First and foremost, I must thank Professor Ganesh and Professor Saha to invite me for this interesting session. The Aditya Institutions probably is doing these series of webinars. They had something yesterday as well. Thank them for inviting me and be part of this thing. It was a very interesting thing, but I think Professor Saha needed much more time to really unjumble this complex jumble. This is what is we learn through decades of experience. I think he's trying to pen down what you really call as experience into a few patterns or few methods which the young students can learn without going through the pains of the experience. But he emphasized on the pains of the experience. Of course, the experience gives you much more wider 360 degree view, and his view might be linear in his understanding, because as you grow, the understandings change, your experiences change. And that is what we all feel when we experience the result of architecture. Architecture is what we call as mother of all arts. So it is not really just building the space. It is how we experience life, how we build lives, how we change lives, and how we understand the nuances of lives over a period of time. It's a very dynamic process. Design, as you have just listed, has to be as dynamic as life is. We have to understand what multi-layered dimensions of life have to be incorporated in the multi-layered responses of the solutions we find. So it is just not physical per se, but it is the emotional, the psychological, the economics, the life patterns of it. I think you covered everything in a very, very broad manner. I think you can have almost evolve out of a series of lectures out of each chapter of it for the students to really understand. And they nearly need to do a hands-on thing with every exercise. That's what probably will give them a much better workshop. I think it's for the faculty of the institution to take it forward from what there and let it be a interactive session, because with these kind of one-way communications, probably we don't know whether it's all getting through their experiences as well, which is the handicap of the virtual meets. Probably we do a physical meet, we kind of face read and understand whether everybody is kind of grasping the thing or there are. So those issues are challenges which we need to build on. And I'm sure with the experience of all the professors and the teachers who take the design and the other issues, every issue will of course be experimented by the individual student or the architect or the professor at his own level, by what his beliefs, values are. Mm-hmm. And creativity is coming out of these challenges, because if you don't put through those pains, what you call pains of the life, the questions asked are not right. I think your whole first series is understanding the right issues. And if you know the right issues, then you really come up with many options which give you the right solutions. So the biggest challenge in design, to my sense, whether it is from site selection to the final solution to the interior landscape, is finding the right issues. And you give them a multi-layered point-wise pattern, but I hope they don't absorb themselves into the jargon of words. They kind of understand it their own experience, because too many factors to young students might also be thinking that they are really getting into a very tough phase, which is not there. They have to simplify it into their own patterns and understand how they convert them into solutions in life. And it is just not for architecture. It is about life. So everything on this, they can take it to their life as well. It is on every aspect of life. It is about relationships. It is about how they enjoy life, how they live life. It is about their life as well. And that's what I think is very important. It is a good thing that we are now discussing all this at a very young age with them. I think we had to all go through this through our academic work, whether we do it, whether we read books or we learn it from our gurus or the guru shiksha kind of Aditi, which gave us the nuances of design, nuances of the human psychology. I think you've done a more pattern on human psychology in that sense, that how will the user, the interface, converter of that emotion to the final solution will be. And I think if the students can really adapt from this and build on it, it will be a really, really great contribution to the system of education. We all have evolved. The so-called information is now available at everybody's hand. So that information, so whatever we say is might be available everywhere, but how you experience that is what is important. And that's why we understand and we'll be trying to evolve ourselves with the changing challenges education and pedagogy is feeling now, since students are exposed to information all around. Unlike historically when we used to kind of transmit it only through few mediums, now we have a very different way of, so in that sense students don't accept everything what we say per se, and that's a very good thing. That means why they're challenging everything. Information gives them the opportunity to challenge whether the methodology or the process the student or the teacher is giving is right or wrong, or that's the way he absorbs it. I think that was a very important thing. They said the students must have the my experiential thing, and I'll just sum it up in a minute or so, that finding the right answers or finding the right questions in the first way to the multi-layered issues which we see in every aspect of life. And then of course, when you're intermediately reviewing the process, you have to zoom in and zoom out of the situation every time. Mm-hmm. That zoom in and zoom out will give you whether you're going wrong at somewhere. And unless you do that and you keep building a linear process, you might at the end of the whole process end up finding that you're not finding the right solutions where you started off. Like life, everything is very, very, it is not a very simple mathematical thing. For us, architecture is more the intangibilities which we have to find, intangibilities which the engineering solution is not able to find. I think that is what is very important. We, of course, get stuck with the assumptions or the case studies which you, as you gave a few examples of. That should not be the binding thought in the student's mind. Finally, how they absorb the process of their own building up of their own lives is what they finally respond in solutions. And I've said that's what is what we call the emotional quotient of a person, which has become much more important than what our cultural upbringing these students had will give a response to what questions and solutions they are finding at. So it is the more experimental or more widened their experience of life is, they'll have much better options to give solutions to. And I must congratulate all of you, and I hope that this gives better results and better thoughts to the students to build on. And I think it will be a wonderful opportunity for them to come back to you with whatever queries they have on their individual aspect, and you respond to them in mail, whatever way I think the institution can build on. And congratulations to Professor Sa and Ganesh and his team to keep doing these efforts. And I think we can build on to this. This is a very wonderful idea. Technology is helping us. And even in these times, we are giving students the time to contemplate and build on. Best of luck to all the students.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. With today's session, we are completing the July series. We'll be continuing the EEED incubation webinar series from September onwards every week. And wait, this is not the end. Now we are excited to announce August Gala Week, a week full of fun, excitement, learning, celebrating, etc. And should mention a stress-releasing month for all of us. Let's see this through a short video prepared by our students. Now, please may I invite our director, Dr. K.N. Ganesh Babu, sir, for the concluding address.
Yeah, thank you. It was an excellent presentation with a very short notice given to you, Ms. Lokanathan. Thank you so much for the efforts. Your explanation on this user interface, principles of uncovering empathy and sympathy, passion. I've written down about 15-20 points. Probably I'll have to get into the dictionary. A lot of vocabulary I've learned in architecture after probably 25 years. Excellent. And as rightly Kapil sir has said, we are exposing all these new terms to our younger generation at their own, readily available to them. I thank you for the wonderful presentation. And probably it was a little fast. We'll see how the series can go on. With the suggestion of our guest on the practical session post-pandemic. Thank you. And as you said, sir, Kapil sir, this incubation session was started for a physical session in our college as guest lectures and series of workshops and interactions, etc. And at one point of time when it got broke in March, we just had a thought why we should not take it as a series of webinars. So we called it the incubation webinar series. So we were able to continue for June and July series. So just to have a change in the modality, I appreciate our team for taking up this August as a gala session, because August is sort of a lean period where academics is over and we're getting into the new academic year in September. Again, it's a fun-filled process of learning. We are not going away from learning. So I would like to invite all the participants to join us in the month of August with all the events, and we will have more details and other posters being flying around. Please join us in August, and we will be back in September every week with this incubation session. So join us, and with this, I would like to thank you all for participating. Thank you both the speaker and the guest for joining us in the evening today. Over to you, Ashwini. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. With this, we come to the end of the session. Before I proceed with the vote of thanks, we just want to take a moment and pay our endless gratitude to all the frontline warriors and healthcare workers for self-sacrificing commitment, unwavering responsibility, and courage amidst the crisis. All of us at Triple AD are grateful to all of the people who are risking their lives and working tirelessly to help our community stay safe. Let us thank the Almighty for giving us strength and keeping us safe at this time of pandemic. It's an honor to present a vote of thanks in the presence of such esteemed guests. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Architect Lokinath Saha, sir, for accepting our invitation to share your exemplary input on design thinking. Your presentation showed participants how to shape their thoughts on design. I thank our guest of honor, Architect Kapil Sethia, sir, for joining us today on our platform. I would like to especially thank our director, Dr. K.N. Ganesh Babu, sir, for constantly encouraging us and adding feathers to our institution. As no program can become successful with one single person. So I extend my big thanks to Architect Sensil and Architect Siddhartha, sir, our webinar coordinators, and Architect Ashita, our broadcasting coordinator, for ensuring that the webinar series continues smoothly. I also thank the management of Aditya Group of Institutions for extending this support always. I thank all the delegates, esteemed members of the architectural fraternity who joined us today. With this, we conclude today's session. We'll continue to present eminent speakers to you from September. Till then, stay tuned with us for August Gala Week. Thank you and stay safe.
Thank you very much.